Hi, everyone, and welcome to the Conversation with St. Patrick Studio. My name is Brian Cannon. Today, we are joined by Deacon Joe Herrera from the Cochiti Pueblo in New Mexico. And he is now our deacon here at St. Patrick. What we're going to do is we're going to have a conversation because November is Native American Heritage Month. And being from the reservation, English is actually your second language, is
that
right?
Correct, that's right.
So let's have a little bit of a conversation about your upbringing, your culture, and how it intersects with your Catholic faith. So okay. Deacon Joe, welcome to the conversation.
Thank you.
So tell me a little bit about how you were raised.
Well, I was, both my parents worked, and so they were off the reservation, and I was blessed with the care of my grandparents, and they brought me up in Cochiti Pueblo. Where my grandfather was actually the governor of the village, and my grandmother was an artist, and so she was prolific in her artwork. And as I said, English was my second language. Neither of my parents spoke to me in English all the time when I was home. That's how my grandparents raised me, with just our own language. And it's in the Pueblo tribe, there's 19 villages, and amongst those 19 villages, there's five languages spoken, all very distinct from one another. So I happen to speak the Cayrican language.
Give us a little taste of what that language
The way we
like.
Would say a greeting was, if it's singular, it's kuetsi. For a plural, with many, it's a kuetsina. That means, greetings.
Now, what I found absolutely intriguing about the Pueblo culture, where you're from, is this mixture of beliefs and systems. You even mentioned to me that there are patrons for the different villages. So how do you mix those, the native culture with like the Roman Catholic Church?
Well, good question. In the 1500s, of course, the Spaniards came into New Mexico, and along with them, they brought the Franciscan friars. And so we, in essence, didn't really have a choice of, the kind of religion that they preferred because they, so to speak, conquered us and were watching over us. And but so there was a little mix of some tension, but we understood what their faith was trying to do, reverence to a God, a supreme being, and we too on our reservation also have a one God, type of an approach, and so we mixed the two. And today, many of the villages actually mix much of the cultural aspects of the of the traditions. Yeah, we do dances inside the church. And for each patron saint celebration, like our July 14th is the feast of Saint Bonaventure, and so we do a dance in our village, and it's open to the public. And the first dance in the village by the villagers is always done in front of the Catholic Church to honor Saint Bonaventure, and then they go to the plaza, where is our kind of our worship center, and that's where we do the dances, the traditional dances.
This enculturation is something that's experienced throughout cultures worldwide, because in the Catholic faith, sometimes especially in the Latin rite, the Western rite, what we would call the Roman Catholic Church, mm-hmm. we forget that there's a bunch of other Catholic churches within the Catholic Church, and most of those are very localized. They are within a culture, they're within a language, some of those Eastern Catholic churches. And that was the beginning of the Latin rite too. It's the Roman Catholic mm-hmm. Church, meaning that it's centered along Rome. But now we have this phenomenon of this very localized rite mm-hmm. gets spread worldwide. So right. you have encountering different cultures all over the world. Is that right?
Correct.
Yeah. So how do some of those native practices from your people incorporate into the life of the church? And one of the things that I wanted to point out is the pouch that you're wearing. Mm-hmm. And would you maybe show that off a little bit and talk about it?
Okay, the men in the village, when we're initiated, we always have what we call a medicine pouch. And within this medicine pouch is what we call cornmeal. And cornmeal is a very sacred, it's kind of like holy water. And whenever we enter a building or bless someone, bless a place, we always sprinkle cornmeal, and it's very sacred. You always breathe on it, and then you bless it, and then you ask for blessings back. So this is in all our traditional ceremonies, we always carry that with us.
I saw something kind of funny the other day, and it was a question. And the question was, what do people assume is in the Bible, but is actually 100% not in the Bible? And I was expecting an answer was like, you know, sometimes there's movie quotes that you recite so many times, but it's not actually in the movie. So I'm expecting a quote from Jesus that he never said or anything like that. But the answer was very different and was really funny. The answer of what is actually not in the Bible is white people. I thought it was like kind of, well, it's 100% true, mm-hmm. right? But we're so used to, I'm so used to going to an art museum and I see like the Northern European paintings of Jesus as a Northern European, and that's what I see on crucifixes and things like that. So from the perspective of your culture, can you describe Jesus?
Okay. I think that, I think Vatican II opened the doors, you know, to enculturation, and I think it really opened the doors to, I guess, not only the Catholic faith, but, you know, people from the outside understanding what's inside Native America. And, you know, there were people of many faces, many languages, you know, many tribes. And I think that, you know, many people can see that now that people that know Christ see it in so many different faces, whatever color it may be, whatever, again, whatever tribe, whatever culture. I mean, there's so many. So I think that's probably something that I think many people can appreciate now, is mm-hmm. that it's widened our vision. In fact, in our Archdiocese, when I was the Director of Native American Ministry, and we annually put on a Native American Mass with Archbishop in attendance, he had always would appreciate the Native Americans' contribution to the Roman Catholic faith, and that he always stood at the, you know, at the ambo saying, you can be Catholic and you can be Native American at the same time. So there was a mutual appreciation of what you know, what Native America contributed to the faith, and that really enhanced you know, the participation amongst the Native people, because they were appreciated, you know, and I think that goes for, you know, any place in the world, you know, that if they're appreciated by, you know, they'll come.
That's right, and there's an enrichment that happens,
yes,
because of that. Like, you know, growing up, I would not have imagined dancing in the church, you know, mm-hmm. but maybe growing up where you are, it's unimaginable to not dance in the church.
Correct.
Right? And so things like artistic expression, music, prayer, they all have to be in our own languages that
Correct.
We understand, that are rooted in our human experience.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
And so as a child, I could imagine growing up where you grew up, if all I ever see is European Jesus. Mm-hmm. It seems so very other, mm-hmm. I would imagine. Mm-hmm. And maybe prayer life can be like that too. So can you tell me a little bit about your own prayer life, your experience with prayer, and how it relates to your culture?
Well, as young children, typically grandparents, are, at least in my time growing up, were took care of you, because the parents are usually working either in town or in the fields, whatever. And so, but the grandparents would teach you to pray immediately. You know, the minute you began to learn how to talk, they would teach you prayers, you know, along with, you know, just teaching you the common language. But they also began to teach you songs, and the songs are prayers. You know, many people don't understand that in our ceremonies, particularly the religious ceremonies, the songs are prayers. Mm. And so, you know, from that, I think, I learned that every aspect of what I did was to be prayerful. In fact, in our language, or in our tribe, there's no word for religion. In our language, we call it manyu, which means way of life. So when we talk about religion, it should always be, what is your way of life, not just, yeah, I'm a Roman Catholic, or, you know, a Presbyterian, or whatever that might be. It's, right. you know, how you live your life, you know, daily.
Right.
And so in our village, Yeah, there was a church, but we also have our own native church, which is, you know, many of you have experience going to a Pueblo village, and there's a round kiva. That's our church. And inside there, there's, you know, we do the songs, we do the prayers, and we do our worship there. So, you know, there's a lot of ritual. And then, you know, when we moved that over to the Catholic Church, you know, also filled with ritual, you know, all of a sudden the people began to understand, you know, these things kind of have meaning. But then the Catholic Church also said, wow, you know, if we can, you know, bring some of what rituals are within the, you know, native tradition into the church, the reservation, that brings more people because now they understand. And so there's a marriage, you know, of two, you know, traditions, you know, the Roman Catholic and the native tradition.
And you recognize that they're sourced from the same place,
yes.
Which is the true beauty of it, is because it's this universal human experience, which we know, you know, the word Catholic means universal.
Yeah.
And it comes by it honestly, right? Mm-hmm. That there is something about how God has created us that we have understandings in common, mm-hmm. regardless of the culture. The expressions of them are different. Mm-hmm. Right. But when we're able, I'll use the word marriage. And I think that's beautiful because in a marriage, two things come together and they become something more than the sum of their parts.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And so I think that's what you've described in terms of ritual. And I love, you know, you bring up the kiva or some of the other mm-hmm. things that are used in your own cultural expressions. And I wonder if there's other signs or symbols that you can talk about that we can, who are looking in from the outside to the culture, learn from. What are some of those signs and symbols?
Well, let's use just some things that are coming up. We have All Souls Day coming up, you know, and it's we've done this from time immemorial because we also celebrate All Souls Day, you know, on the reservation. And we go into our respective houses of worship, not just the kiva, because there's many societies within each village, you know, and I belong to one of those. So all those within our society, you know, come to that place of worship. We sing songs, and then we remember the dead. And, you know, prayer feathers are prepared by the medicine societies. And, you know, each feather, you know, for each member that has passed, you know, that we remember. And then all of those, when we gather, or when we remember all those, then we gather them all. And then young men take those feathers out to a distant place on a hill or a mountain and facing the village and bury those feathers. And because now it is those the spirits of those that have gone now will look over the village people. So that's, you know, that's some of the symbols, you know, that kind of mix, you know, with the Catholic faith. And so there's, you know, there's really no celebration, you know, with the Catholic Church, but they understand that what they're doing is very similar to what will happen in church.
Right. So that ritual that you've described is so great because if I were there watching it, I would have some understanding of it because that's the way that symbol and ritual work, right? Mm-hmm. Even mm-hmm. people who wander into a Catholic church, you know, they'll have some understanding of what's going on, but it's not until somebody breaks it open with you that you realize it is that universal experience. It is what your family celebrates, albeit with different names and in a different way.
Right.
So that's one ritual or experience that's upcoming. Are there any other examples?
Yeah, again, at this time of the year, there's a change of seasons. And Native Americans, at least the Pueblo tribe, have a great appreciation for this time of the year because now the sun moves to the south. And we have ceremonies just for that. We have some particular songs where we send the sun back to the south. And, you know, because now that's where the sun goes back to fertilize, you know, mm-hmm. what is in the south, you know. And so we have, you know, we thank the gifts that, you know, the sun has afforded us, and we send it. And then in the spring, we bring it back, you know. So it's interesting how we appreciate the seasons and, you know, everything kind of revolves around, you know, environment and appreciation of the earth. And I think that's something paramount to us all, especially in today's time, that we appreciate what Mother Earth has, you know, has afforded us. And, you know, how can we care for it? And how can we care for others in another hemisphere? And so now through prayers, we are sending the sun back to those that need it for, you know, for their own, you know, sake, to, you know, for rain and growth and, you know, all that.
The idea of connection to the earth, which is so essential for survival, right? Mm-hmm. You have to understand the seasons.
Yes.
You have to understand the planting and when the rains are happening and when they're not. And in our culture and society here, we can tend to be so removed from that cycle. We know when pumpkin spice latte season is, but like to actually have it affect our very life, right? So that integration of life and understanding, which now kind of brings it full circle.
Right.
I understand why you might not have a word for religion
right
in your culture, because it's simply the way of life.
Correct.
Sorry. Any other wisdom that we can gain from our conversation today?
Well, I think that I certainly hope that there are people now that can go visit reservations with an openness and appreciation for the culture that exists there, that the people are always open. You know, they're always very welcoming, as, you know, a parish would be, you know, where they would welcome you into their homes and feed you. And that happens in pueblos, you know, throughout the Southwest, where on feast days, they open all their homes, welcome everybody and feed them. You know, send them home with, you know, gifts of food and whatever.
Yeah,
and
you're speaking my language now. There's going to be food. I'm going to be there.
So, you know, I think that, you know, that's a lesson for all of us, that, you know, we as people appreciate and worship and in much the same way. And it's just we all do it in little different ways, you know, and just to appreciate how others might do it. Yeah, I think it gives us value, you know, that, you know, we're doing something really good.
Now, this is just for fun. I'm not letting you off the hook on this one, because we talked a little bit before about you met a very interesting person in the course of your dancing career.
Yes.
Want to talk a little bit about that?
Well, I was fortunate. In my 1962 through 67, I was a dancer at the Indian Village at Disneyland. And so during my summers of my high school and college life, I danced at Disneyland and was fortunate to meet Disney and Walt Disney, Uncle Walt, as we called him.
That's right.
And, you know, there's something about him too that people need to recognize, is that whenever there was a foreign dignitary that came into Disneyland, he would always greet them at the very at the entrance to Disneyland. First thing they would do is go around on the train, and then they get back down to Main Street. They take them in one of those little buggies, and they drive, you know, down Main Street into Frontierland, into the Indian Village, because he would always tell his dignitaries, "This is where America began." He was very proud of Native Americans and the Indian Village.
Amazing story.
Yeah.
Is it really the happiest place on earth?
Yes.
Of course it is. Yes, of course it is. Deacon Joe Herrera, thank you so much for such a great conversation. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome.
This has been The Conversation with St. Patrick's Studio. My name is Brian Cannon, and we will see you next time.